Good morning, children. Here I am with the last video session of the chapter The Making of the National Movement 1870 to 1947. Children, in the previous videos we have discussed about various methods of protest adopted by moderate leaders, by extremist leaders and by the revolutionaries. We all know that Indians were not at all happy with the British rule, and now they want to drive them out of our country. In this context, there were many movements which were started by different political leaders, in which the role of Mahatma Gandhi is quite notable. Today we are going to read about another movement which was started by Mahatma Gandhi, which is very well known by the name Civil Disobedience Movement, which was started in the year 1930. So, let us discuss about this movement. The Indian National Congress emerged as the representatives of all India sentiments and decided to steer the national struggle in another direction. On December 31, 1929, the Indian National Congress, in its annual session at Lahore, passed the resolution of Purna Swaraj, or complete independence. This session was presided over by Jawaharlal Nehru. In this session, tricolor was hoisted and the Indians were asked to celebrate January 26, 1930 as the Independence Day. Gandhiji was placed in charge of the civil disobedience movement by the Congress Working Committee. Civil disobedience movement started on March 12, 1930. It was initiated with the Salt March or the Dandi March. It aimed at defying the British government and pressurizing it to give it to their demands. The British government imposed tax on collection of salt, which was an item of daily use. Mahatma Gandhi decided to break the salt law because it affected everybody in the country. To break the salt law, Mahatma Gandhi started the historic Dandi March from Sabarmati Ashram with his 78 other members to the coastal village of Dandi, which was about 390 kilometers away from Sabarmati Ashram. It took 24 days to complete this march. The salt march reached Dandi at sunset on April 5th. On April 6th, Mahatma Gandhi broke the salt law by collecting sea water from the beach. It was a signal for the whole nation to violate the salt law and start the civil disobedience movement. The civil disobedience movement soon gathered momentum. It extended to violation of other laws and refusal to pay taxes. The program of civil disobedience included hartals, non-payment of unjust taxes, boycott of foreign goods, demonstrations, and picketing shops selling foreign goods. A large number of women actively participated in this movement. Sarojini Naidu was one of the leaders of this movement. Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan, also known as Frontier Gandhi, led to the civil disobedience movement in the northwest frontier provinces. He supported the movement by holding the payment of taxes. Khan was also the founder of Khudai Khidmatgar. The British did not expect that salt march would lead to any dire consequences, but soon they realized the mistake and took repressive measures to crush the movement. Congress was declared unlawful, Mahatma Gandhi and other important leaders were put behind the bars. These acts, instead of cooling down, intensified the spirit of civil disobedience. The first roundtable conference was held in London on November 12, 1930 to discuss the proposal of the Simon Commission. Many representatives attended the conference, but the Congress boycotted it. Due to the absence of the Congress, this conference could not achieve its goals. The government now made attempts to negotiate an agreement with the Congress so that it would participate in the next round of deliberation to be held in 1931. Leading Congress leaders, including Gandhiji, were unconditionally released on January 25, 1931. An agreement was signed between Viceroy Lord Irwin and Gandhiji. According to the agreement, Mahatma Gandhi agreed to suspend the civil disobedience movement and also to participate in the second roundtable conference. The second roundtable conference was presided over by the British Prime Minister Ramsay MacDonald. Mahatma Gandhi was the sole representative of the Congress. The conference was mainly devoted to looking for the solution of communal problems. The delegates of the Muslim League, the Anglo-Indians, the Sikhs, and the other such group insisted on acknowledging communal claims. The conference ended in a failure and a disappointed Mahatma Gandhi returned to India. Lord Wellington, who succeeded Lord Irwin as the Viceroy of India in April 1931, was not in favor of Gandhi-Irwin Pact. He ignored many provisions of the pact. Consequently, even before Gandhiji's return, the Congress renewed the civil disobedience movement in the first week of January 1932. This time, the government acted swiftly and immediately arrested Gandhiji and other leaders of the Congress. The Congress was declared illegal. The press was suppressed. The government arrested thousands of people. Gandhiji and other leaders had no time to build up the tempo of the movement, and it could not be sustained for long. Although the movement was crushed within a few months, it continued to linger till April 1934 when the decision to withdraw it was taken by Gandhiji. In August 1935, the government announced the Government of India Act. Its main features were as follows. India was to become a federation if more than half of the princely states decides to join it. Provincial autonomy was granted. The ministers of the provincial governments were to be responsible to all the legislature. The power of the legislature was also increased. The right to vote, however, remained limited. Only 14% people had voting rights. Diarchy was abolished at the provincial level but introduced at the center. The viceroy became more powerful and was not responsible to the legislature. The act was rejected by the Congress. The Congress, however, decided to contest the election to the provincial legislative assemblies to be held in 1937. In these elections, it won an absolute majority of seats in 6 provinces. In 3 provinces, it emerged as the single largest party. It formed ministers on its own in 7 out of 11 provinces. These ministries did useful work in the field of education and upliftment of the Harijans. So we can conclude that the Government of India Act 1935 was a detailed document with the following features. Number 1, an All India Federation. Number 2, responsible government with safeguards. Number 3, separate representation for communal and other groups. And number 4, provincial autonomy. Even though the Congress opposed the provision of the Act, it decided to contest the election. Out of 11 provinces, Congress had its sway in 7 provinces. This proved to the British government that the Congress was still the most popular political party in the country. Good morning, children. Here I am with the last video session of the chapter The Making of the National Movement 1870 to 1947. Children, in the previous videos we have discussed about various methods of protest adopted by moderate leaders, by extremist leaders, and by the revolutionaries. We all know that Indians were not at all happy with the British rule, and now they want to drive them out of our country. In this context, there were many movements which were started by different political leaders, in which the role of Mahatma Gandhi is quite notable. Today we are going to read about another movement which was started by Mahatma Gandhi, which is very well known by the name Civil Disobedience Movement, which was started in the year 1930. So, let us discuss about this movement.